Hi, my name is Joe Cossette. I'm a high school physics teacher in Minnetonka, Minnesota. And like other teachers around the world, my school year this year has looked very different than my school year in past years. Because at the beginning of the year, my school district decided that essentially the first semester of our year is entirely online. So all of the hands-on labs and group activities that I'm used to doing in my physics classroom had to be converted to maintain the same sort of feeling, but in an online setting. In the next 20 minutes, I want to describe some of the different ways that I've gone about this and share some of the resources that I've used and created for this year of online learning. Now, the plan for this video is I want to share some virtual labs that I've used and created to create that same sort of sense of investigation and connection with the content in a real world sort of setting, and then talk about some group-worthy strategies that I've used to make tasks not something that one person can just drift off in a Google Meet or a Zoom call, mute their mic and turn off their camera. They have to be engaged and involved the entire time. And then I'll wrap up at the end and share out some resources in full detail that I talk about in the video. So this video, I want to go through very quickly a lot of different examples, but at the end, there will be a link to some posts where I've posted all of the resources. If you wanted to download and use some of these in your own classroom, you can. Something that I've thought about a lot this year has been creativity in the world of constraints. A book that I've been reading recently was Math with Bad Drawings by Ben Orlin, where he says, you can make the case that all creative endeavors are about pushing against constraints. And that really resonated with me. He also quotes Richard Feynman, where he described science as just imagination with constraints. And this year has felt like a big constraint with COVID and the pandemic. And out of that, I feel like has been born just a different sense of creativity among all teachers, that some of the things that we're creating are some of our best work in some ways. It's certainly not what we want it to be, but the creativity required to get around our constraints has produced some pretty interesting examples. So I want to share some of the ones that have come out of my classroom. So some virtual labs that we've done in this year, I've described these as physics mini labs. I'm not looking at them as a full independent, dependent, collect several trials and graph the data sort of lab, but instead a mini challenge where students have to make measurements to solve a very specific problem. And sometimes that's looked like a physics of a viral video. Sometimes it's some scenario that I've created and recorded, or sometimes it's a simulation that students are interacting with online. I want to go through some different examples of each of these categories that have been a staple in my classroom this year. First is a physics of a viral video. Students love seeing videos that they have seen elsewhere being used in class. And this is a video on TikTok that made the rounds earlier this year. Now, the natural response of that for any student or really any human is, how tall was that cliff? How high did he jump from? Well, a physicist knows that all you really need is the time of that fall to calculate the height if you can use kinematics and free fall with the assumption of an initial velocity of zero and acceleration of gravity of 9.81. Now, the task for the students there is to figure out what they need to measure in order to solve for that unknown. In a similar spirit, I've also used this video this year. In this video taken at a football training camp, this wide receiver, I believe, now plays for Illinois, and he jumps 47.1 inches in the air, which is just insane. That's so high. I had students calculate from this video what his hang time was. It's very similar to a lab that I did in person. But something that we are all using the same data, so it's easier for us to verify together in this online setting. Now, the nice part about this lab is once you've calculated that, you can go back and measure to see if what you calculated makes sense. So if you calculate a time of 3 seconds and then measure that it clearly isn't 3 seconds, you have a built-in check to see if your answer is correct. It's not a teacher saying yes or no. Getting into our friction unit, there are 3 videos that I used to talk about coefficient of friction where these are all sliding to a stop. I had students choose one of these three to calculate the coefficient of friction that was present. So here are the three videos that I used. The first is a TikTok of a guy playing with his puppy.
Good, my happy, happy guy. Oh, just a happy, happy, happy guy. Oh, just a look at that.
Adorable. The next is a video of a fire station dog coming in for the sliding stop. And then the last example is one that many people are familiar with from the movie Risky Business. Just take those old records off the shelf. So the common thread in all of these videos is it's either a dog or a Tom Cruise sliding to a stop. And because of that, there is some sort of kinetic friction that is creating the conditions for that to happen. The task for the students is to calculate that coefficient of kinetic friction. To do that, you really need two values. You need to know how far they slid, the displacement of the slide, and how long it took to slide to the stop. So what is the time there? For this lab, I, ahead of time, figured out some sort of assumed distance. I estimated that based on the video, and I provided that displacement for them, where all they had to do was collect a time from the video and solve for the unknown of coefficient of friction. It's counterintuitive, but you don't actually need to know the mass in this case because mass cancels out along the way. If you want, it would be a great estimation exercise to not actually provide the displacement and have students estimate on their own. I provided it because I wanted a little bit more constraints to make it easier to check their answers, but it'd be a great exercise as well. Now, with all of these, it's useful to have a tool that makes it easy to measure the time, because the time is really the main thing that they're calculating and each or measuring from each of those. In our class, we've used the app Huddle Technique. It can be found on the iOS. It's free, and it's really nice because you can scroll to a particular time in the video and zero out the stopwatch and then scroll to a different time to essentially time an event in a specific video that you've either downloaded or recorded yourself. There are other ways to do this. You could also just use the time scrubber on the video itself. It doesn't get quite as precise as this would, but it gives you a pretty good idea. If you use Pivot Interactives, that is a tool that can also do this, and that is a really powerful tool that can do this and overlay things like a ruler to measure displacement that way as well. In my classroom, we haven't used Pivot Interactives, not because I don't think it's amazing. I think it's a phenomenal resource, but because we just didn't have the time or monetary resources to invest this year in that particular tool. So we just found other ways around that, like Huddle Technique. So those are all examples of videos that I was able to find online and use instead of a word problem. So something that students had to collect a time before they could measure. Another example of labs that I've done is a teacher-created lab. So here, for example, I might drop a bowling ball next to the side of my house where students get this video. They can time that and then use the height of my sighting to figure out how high it is, to calculate how fast it had hit, and then also find a lot of different positions along the way, since the sighting is even increments of 26 centimeters, roughly, to create a really nice freefall graph, graphing the position versus time. We've also looked at some teacher-created videos to calculate some things with momentum, a classic momentum collision, a hit and bounce here. For these bowling balls, I give them the mass of the bowling ball on the right. Their task is to calculate the mass of the bowling ball on the left. To do that, you need to know the velocity of each before and after. So I have overlaid a ruler here with my video editing software, as well as a timer that they can scrub to different parts of the video to calculate the velocity before and after for each of the bowling balls to ultimately calculate the final mass of the bowling ball on the left. A side story on this, I thought this was going to be a really easy, straightforward lab. Turns out that the mass that you calculate for that bowling ball is not exactly the same as the mass that it actually is. So I don't reveal right away the mass, the actual mass of that bowling ball on the left, because in that collision, some of the momentum is transferred to the Earth, that the system turns out isn't purely just the two bowling balls. So we don't get into the complexity of that right away. I say that we're assuming a closed system of just the two bowling balls where the momentum is conserved between the two. But then after the fact, I do share with them the overall complexities that make that prediction not exactly correct. And then another example that I've used in momentum and energy is the classic ballistic pendulum. In this case, it's a much larger ballistic pendulum than typically is used.
Smells good. All right.
In my classroom, I fire off a potato gun into a giant bucket. So this is a video that I had collected from earlier in a different year. And I overlay a time in the barrel and a height measurement so that you can calculate from the height that the bucket swings, what is the conservation of energy leading to the conservation of momentum to calculate the potato's exit velocity. And if you know that, you can figure out the potato cannon's force if you know the time in the barrel. So again, it's essentially a word problem that I could give them on a test or a worksheet, but it's one that they have to calculate from a video. And then a classic lab that many people use is the flying livestock, flying pigs in a circle for circular motion. For this, I just collected a bunch of photographs of the pig in motion to take some measurements here to produce this overall diagram of the length of the string, the height of the pig, and then the mass of the pig. And from that, they have to figure out and predict the time it would take to go 10 times around. And the video that I use here is just to check their answer in the end. I expect them to be within 1 second for full points. If you do the numbers correctly, you should be able to get within half a second to calculate that for those full 10 revolutions. So in this case, the video isn't something that they're taking a measurement from, but rather using it to check their answer in the end. And then, of course, I've also used simulations in my class as a way that students can interact with some of the materials. If you haven't used Physics Aviary in the past, it is a phenomenal treasure trove of different simulations and online labs. This one that I used in my energy and work unit is basically a simulation of a little astronaut dude where he fires a fire extinguisher to accelerate over a certain distance and then time the final velocity in this photo gate. Now, I have them choose just a random of their choice, force, distance, and mass, to then predict using work and energy how fast he should be going and what the time should be through that photo gate. Then they do it and see how close they were. If it doesn't match the simulation, they need to go back and try their numbers again. That is the check to see if they understand the mechanics of that system. Then part two is I want them to determine settings to achieve a photo gate target time of 750 milliseconds. So they have to determine what settings are needed to produce that outcome. Other simulations that I've used, ultimately FET is the gold standard. I love the simulations that you can have some sort of target lab still. So the sine or the Snell's law simulation has a mystery material that you can calculate the refractive index for that mystery material, which isn't known. They have to make measurements to do it like they would in a classroom. All right, to end off here, I want to talk about some examples of how different tasks could be group worthy. Any of these labs, I think, are great labs, but ultimately they're individual labs. In a group setting, a lot of times I found that somebody would take charge and others would watch. And I wanted some sort of activity or activities that they didn't have that option, that they had to be involved. So at the end of all of our mechanics units, so motion, forces, energy, and momentum, I posed this group challenge in form of a lab practical where they had to calculate as many properties as they could about this video that I created.
Thank you.
All right, so that hurts every time I watch it. A little bit more interesting than just a ball rolling down a ramp, since I put my body on the line. Well, the task here was to calculate as many things as they could, and the official rubric was basically looking at quantity, how many of these properties they were able to calculate correctly. They had to get 18 plus in order to get full credit. And this is group worthy because there weren't any listed values present. So they had to work as a group to figure out what they actually knew how to solve, and the different perspectives made that task more bearable. They also needed to collaborate to verify their answers. So a chance to make sure that they were doing the calculation correctly and kind of bounce ideas off of each other. I had students, groups that calculated 22, 25 different properties. Some that got a little too creative that I had to limit the responses a little bit. Some gave me the predicted temperature outside. Some gave me the expansion constant of the universe. So they got pretty creative with that, but found it to be a very group worthy, something that they really felt the need to work together as a team. Another more elaborate task that I used to create a similar sort of response was an escape room that happened virtually. I made groups of three or four where every student received a Google form with a series of challenges that I called doors and data validations. So they had to submit the correct answer before moving on in their Google form. What made this group worthy is that the clues interacted with each other. So they all had their own individual Google form, but their clues required information that somebody else had. So for example, door one started out very simple, that it was just a constant velocity problem where they had to solve something like how far this wiener dog went over a given amount of time. They had all the information that they needed. But door number two gets a little bit more complex. It's a kinematics problem, like this one here, calculating the time that it takes Usain Bolt to accelerate to a final velocity of 9.6 meters per second. They don't have all the information that they need to solve that. But one of their teammates has a did you know that says Usain Bolt accelerates at 3 meters per second squared. So they have to figure out which of their teammates has the missing information for them to solve their task to move on to door three. Door three is a lot more collaborative. It's one problem that they're all working on together. And in this case, they need to figure out the length of this snake in meters, but they have different pictures depending on the different player that they are. So player one has the snake compared to water bottles. Player two has a water bottle with pennies. Player three has pennies and a playing card. And then player four has a playing card and a ruler. And they have to work together to create conversion factors and use dimensional analysis to solve for that unknown. So it becomes more and more collaborative that nobody is really allowed to sit out because all of these are needed to solve that problem. Then it continues on in a variety of different ways. Door four has graphs where they each have a different graph and then three questions. One question about their own graph and then two questions about someone else's graph that they need to communicate with each other and help each other out to solve their own problems that they are depending on each other to get there. Some doors, like door eight, each person has part of a scenario, in this case, an animation. And then the fourth player has a bunch of different motion graphs that they need to determine a displacement and a velocity graph that depicts the entire motion that's animated of this car. So they have to work together to describe what's going on in words because they're either screen sharing or trying to explain what they're seeing. And then door nine, the final door, they have to figure out the length of a ramp for this marble to roll down in 2 seconds. But they all are looking through a peephole to see one part of this. When they submit this final door, they get a confirmation code that they then submit to the teacher. This worked out to be a great group-worthy task. It took all hour for my students. It was something that they were collaborating the entire time and reviewing along the way all these different parts of motion. It'd be really easy to change some of these tasks to different content if you want to do a similar thing, or to do this task with less doors is also pretty easy to just delete things from that Google form. So in summary, we've talked about these three things. I look forward to collaborating with other people during the live portion of this, but if you're interested in more details about the things in this presentation, the links are posted here or you can follow me on Twitter. All right, look forward to communicating a little bit more in the future.